I've called my speech Foolish Dream of a Clean Table, and underline a common path acting as both a burden and an inspiration. What to do with borders, with minorities? I will pose the question here of whether or not it is ever possible to somehow overcome the past, or how the current Czech phrase sounds, whether it is possible to come to terms with it, at least in the sense that it would not constantly give us, the neighboring nations and states in Central Europe, sticks in our hands, that it would release our minds from prejudice and idiosyncrasies, and that it would not force us to continue with old regrets, mistrusts, and hostilities. I am mainly considering the Visegrad member countries and their surrounding areas. I am considering disputes over borders and over minorities. Most likely, we will find out about the chances and threats before us when we take upon us the task on investigating our past sine ira et studio. It means when we primarily look upon ourselves critically and also attempt to look at the past in the perspective of others. This is the most difficult task. I can already see how in the Czech Republic, upon hearing such words, people will speak in resistance, self-inflicting harm, flagellation. Flagellation, however, gives me the least cause for concern in regards to my country. It is the exact opposite. We are rather preserving ourselves and planting the seeds of our wounds so that they can continue to hurt for a long time. There was, is, and most likely always be the same foolish illusion, old as civilization itself, the illusion that there are moments when it is possible to start over with a clean table, for a moment as if paradise, innocent, freed from the burdens of the past, a fresh start. People will believe in something like this for time following big coups, revolutions after big changes. The path which we had followed can be forgotten following the fall of communism, some said in late 1989. All regrets, idiosyncrasies ingrained under the skin, stiff heterostereotypes will hopefully not stand in the way next time. We are starting anew, starting to build a new world from the ground up. Specifically, a new Central Europe, the place that was once culturally and spiritually the most colorful and productive. We, the new generations, unburdened by the past. Generations that were active during times when old regime collapsed. We will now build it not just for ourselves, but for all of Europe, which had in the past allowed for its center to be kidnapped, by the words of Milan Kundera. I remember the very first foreign visit of the delegation of coordination center of the Civic Forum in December of 1989. As its representative, I led it into Polish Cieszyn without hesitation, where we met with Adam Michnik. My first trip as chairman of the new government, again without any hesitation, led right into Hungary in March 1990. Moreover, it was Bratislava, right the next day after my designation, unlike Václav Havel, who went to Munich and Berlin. So we perceived our path into Europe, together with our neighbors, with whom we have a shared experience of a post-war past. This will now strengthen us and bring us together. In the spring of that year, a conference of politicians, historians, and philosophers was held at the Bratislava Castle regarding the future of Visegrad. The presidents at the time were Václav Havel, Lech Walesa, and soon to join them, Arpad Gens. A shared path full of misunderstanding and strife was in no way being pushed out of our minds at the time. But we, the people of opposition or dissent, did not need to irritate it in order to gain favor with the electorate. We had, at the least, the illusion of a clean table. Dissent and exile during many long years opened up the most sensitive, painful pages of particularly recent history existing in all three of our countries. We were prepared to discuss and act upon them, but we were the exclusive minority that at first refused to admit its exclusivity. It turned out that the cruel, graphic image of Jacques Rupnik was correct regarding what we will discover at the bottom of the freezer. Once upon a long time ago, there were deposited pieces of still bloody meat. Meat is after all always bloody. Some remember it, sometimes like that was indeed there. But then totalitarian or authoritarian regimes turned the freezing to the highest degree, to total forgetting. Now we will open that freezer, take out its contents, and throw it out into a landfill. Then, however, comes the shock. What we take out is something completely different and much worse than that what was put inside in the first place. Time in people's minds simply worked, and substances of rot and decay took their effect on the meat, even through the frost. All wounds did not heal under totalitarian and eventually post-totalitarian regimes. Inside them, new and old pus has been collecting, and now it all quickly melts in the free air. A clean table was once again shown to be an illusion, a dangerous illusion. What was it? What was the bloody meat? Following the Great War, I will refer to it as such because at the time it was not yet known that it was only the first of the world wars. There were new respective old new states, Czechoslovakia, Poland and Hungary. Even the new small Austria and the kingdom of Serbs, Croats and Slovenes, as well as Germany in somewhat diminished borders. Czechoslovakia was brand new. On allegorically styled maps from the end of 16th century, Europe was artificially captured in the form of female figure, and the Czechs were her herd. After the war, Czechoslovak statesmen felt a big responsibility due to this. Yet it is possible they felt more of an opportunity than a responsibility. They did not mention the complete truth about the ethnic composition of the population of the state to the representatives of the winning states of the treaty, that a third of the population is German. This is due to the fact that, according to that, they would have to be the second state-forming nation in the country. Negotiators at the Paris Peace Conference reached almost the maximum limits of borders, and now it was substantial to not show that we don't have enough strength for governing such a diverse state. They rather wanted to set an example more than others. Beneš promised that we would be something like Switzerland in seven places of his memoranda, which he submitted to the Paris Peace Conference. He meant by this that we will be a state of national and religious toleration, just like the Swiss. Even thought the adjective was not yet in circulation at the time, he could have meant by this that above an ethnically varied, even most colorful state of nations and nationalities in Europe, we would be able to vault over a higher floor, a political nation. Was it possible? Czech historian Jan Riklík, however, claims that creating a political nation anew from two or more nations has never been accomplished by anyone, and that had someone done so, they would have received a Nobel Prize for it by now. He adds that if such states exist, then only because they have existed as such for at least several hundred years. He is thinking of Switzerland, which has been working on this for over 700 years. Creating a political nation from a freshly comprised state of ethnically and religiously diverse base of people is supposedly impossible. This is not to say that it should not be worked towards, but rather that it is not a task to be accomplished in only a number of election terms. Post-war ratio were not created only by according to how and where war France finally stopped, although apparently mainly because of this. They were also created from ideas, or rather slogans. Oddly enough, the creators of contagious catchwords that were convenient for arranging post-war Europe, met here and included American idealist Democrat Wilson and Russian cynical pragmatic dictator Lenin, both of which were postulated as a catchword, the right of all nations to self-determination. Lenin added, since he knew that it is merely propaganda and that matters won't be settled with mere words, that it is self-determination up to secession. And as both the Czech Democrats and Czech communists, the ones with the catchword, without the October Revolution, had it not been October 1928, the date of origin of Czechoslovakia, 1918, appealed to, if we are considering the merit of the creation of the independent state, two antipodes with an equally dysfunctional, but that much more zealous catchword to Woodrow Wilson and Vladimir Ilyich Lenin. The statesmen of two empires at the time badly advised smaller ethnic islands in the center of Europe, but also wrongly advised even to the winners in Europe. This resulted in the second act of the Great War. I will also add the enlightened German philosopher Herder to these two politically motivated advisors, who had already 150 years prior inspired the thought in the minds of Germans and Slavs that a nation is made up of those who speak the same language. The triad of Herder, Wilson, Lenin seems far-fetched, but these were three truly decisively steeped out in the Central European destinies. Wilson was then a decisive authority upon which our politicians in exile relied on the most. However, the noble principle confirming the right of every nation to its own state could not have worked even for a moment, nor did it work. A nation here in Central Europe is something different than in Western Europe. It is something natural, a tribe which one cannot choose. People here are born into their nations. Wilson had never been in Europe before. It means not in the center one, and even less so in the Balkans. Furthermore, he had no awareness of the principle of the Russian matryoshka. He had no idea that inside the big doll was a smaller one, also in some kind of a costume, and that inside that one was yet another one, and once more in some kind of a different costume. Yet even then, there isn't an end to the dolls. And all of them in some kind of costume. On Žitný Island, between two streams of Danube, in the middle of the Hungarian minority, in the south of the Slovak Republic, there are islands of Slovak minorities. But in that Slovakian village, in the middle of the Hungarian neighborhood, are certainly several cottages in which Hungarians live, and when there are more than 20% of them, they are bound to want to assert their national rights and assure that the Slovakian mayor speaks to them in Hungarian. Thus, there are many other places like this in the center, east and south of Europe. Wilson was an idealist professor, deeply convinced that ideals work. Masaryk was in many respects similar to him, but he knew that ideals don't work always. Yet he also did not mind sometimes to pretend his belief in them. When he signed the Pittsburgh Agreement at the end of May 1918 with the Slovaks regarding that in one mutual state they will have their own assembly. The more sober Beneš did not add his signature. You will not be able to fulfill that which with your signature you had promised, dared to oppose Masaryk's otherwise loyal and devoted students. All the while, Beneš claimed that until the end of his life, he will not believe in the existence of a distinctive Slovak nation. After years and decades, Beneš suffered from the fact that at the time during negotiations regarding the borders of the state, he succumbed on the one hand to the idealists such as Wilson, and on the other hand to vengeful victors. At first he refused to accept into the borders of the new state so-called northern projections of Czech territory, the Friedland and Shluknov kind. Perhaps he did not even want the Cheb, a Grenzis kind. But he was told exactly the same thing that the Hungarians and Germans were told. Those who lost in this war cannot gain anything, but rather can only lose. They can never gain territory. In other words, the right to self-determination is only reserved for the winners. That was almost rather Lenin's conception, Lenin's cynicism, which of course means that his so-called right to self-determination was never a true right, but merely a phrase to sugarcoat revenge, especially of the French. Understandable, but in no way justifiable. It is worth noting that Beneš never publicly admitted to his formerly realistic attitude toward imposed maximum borders. Only in the weeks prior to Munich, when he indicated that he had already then offered what is being asked of him by Henlein now. He did not admit it because it would have been very unpopular at the time, and Beneš was not only a statesman, but also a politician. The voters, therefore, lived under the illusion that we can and should want everything. Even Masaryk wasn't as such a foolish idealist as he appeared to be. Even in 1924, he dared to write to Perotka's Weekly Presents a letter that he did not sign and in which he contemplated whether or not the line of the southern borders of Slovakia should be reconsidered, by which he meant that the border should be pushed to the south, to the Hungarians. It was realistic, yet completely inappropriate. The president wants to reduce the territory of his own state. Absurd. Supposedly it was Prime Minister Švehla who recognized and rebuked the author. Wilson's ideals regarding Czechoslovakia did not even begin to work. German minorities around the borders of Bohemia, Silesia and Moravia demanded the rights to self-determination to their own little states based on Wilson's promises. Provinces that intended immediately after to determine themselves as part of Austria. They claimed that the same way Czechs had the right to secede from Austria, they themselves have the right to secede from Czechoslovakia. It was immediately explained to them that what was forgotten to be mentioned is that the ideals of self-determination don't apply to the losers. This was a logical explanation, but it had nothing to do with ideals. The logic needed to be supported by shooting at German civilians. A similar situation unfolded in southern Slovakia. This was then already the new Czechoslovakia, at war with the Hungarians and the Poles. Without the help of the French army and their generals, we would have likely not been able to handle a war on two fronts. We even wanted the French army to fight our own battle for the new borders for us. Legions were still far away in the easternmost Russia. Never were disputes over the border resolved in a manner that satisfied both sides. The worst part in that they were once again revived during a time when Czechoslovaks and Poles could and should have stood together against Hitler. Instead, we fought with Poles once more in 1938. The beginning of the existence of independent states in this region did not promise peaceful coexistence nor alliance. All states of the later Visegrad, Poland, Hungary, and Czechoslovakia, were in constant conflict with all neighbors following the Great War. The first two, due to far too large ambitions, us supposedly out of worry. Poland is, until the spring of 1921, in a latent or open war conflict with all of its neighbors. All are bringing up territorial claims to all others. Peace treaties were simply not successful. Could they have ever succeeded? The linking of the idea of national rights to national self-determination by the idea of the winner gets the spoils created an explosive mix that initially deceived due to the fact that after the war it was soaked with the blood of tens of millions of casualties. So thereby our philosopher Emanuel Radl could already in year 1927 predict that a second great war was awaiting Europe and that it would break out due to the circumstances in the Czechoslovakian Sudetenland. Radl was the one who insisted that we finally start building a political nation, but he was almost all alone. The precarious situation following the First War unfortunately did not change and rather lasted until the beginning of the Second War. Czechoslovakia does not have any allies beyond its borders during critical times. Indeed, it does not even have a loyal population within its borders. It seems as if it isn't even making attempts to change anything about this state of being. Edvard Beneš betted on more generous concepts, on the construction of collective security, for us reinforced skillfully by a system of interdependent treaties with France, Great Britain, and the Soviet Union. Next to all of this, the issues with border disputes probably seem petty issues, not only with Těšín, but more so with several little-known territories, with villages in Javorina and mountainous Spišsko on the disputed border with Poland. These seemingly petty problems, however, might decide that Czechoslovakia will not stand against Hitler with the Poles, which could avert the war. I dare say that the other great war perhaps might not have had to break out had the Czechs and the Poles stood side by side, and perhaps all it would have taken were several generous gestures regarding those villages on Spišsko. Yet it would have had to be gestures from both sides, and these gestures could not have been held off until the last minute. Even self-confident Beneš in the last days before Munich suggests that he had a kind of guilty conscience and therefore rescue plan, and it should have been regarding our relations with the Poles. At the time, however, it was already too late. Beneš tragically overestimated his own diplomatic abilities and his good chess-like approach to world diplomacy evidently did not take something like neighbor relations and simply needless disputes between people over their garden fences into account. Czechoslovakia was therefore throughout its entire interwar existence surrounded by enemies and behaved accordingly in response, with the exception of unfortunately useless neighboring Romania. The enemies, however, saw it completely differently. In any case, a small agreement called the Little Entente was a military coalition for defense against the supposedly expansive Hungarians, who, according to common judgment at the time, caused the First World War. They had, of course, felt unjustly punished. We didn't not wish to include the Poles into the treaty, despite the wishes of the French, because they seemed to us to be too close to the Hungarians. This hostility was created and maintained at the onset of the impractical ideals regarding the right of every nation to have its own state. It was created from the ideals, especially then sugar-coated on the maps of meeting halls in Versailles, Saint-Germain and Trianon, born ourselves overseas and modified by understandable worry and revenge of the winners. It is a paradox and to this day instructive. The ideals were not invented in the minds of a political thinker. They were communicated by the president of a democratic state that already had behind him a respectable piece of the road to a political nation, toward a state of citizen loyal to the constitution, the rule of law, the army, and the state symbols. Even this state was still missing a lot of its ideals and still is to this day. These ideals were, however, not only impractical, but also pernicious ideals for Europe, and particularly for her center and eastern part. Its consequences after the war resulted in legitimizing the expulsion of the Germans and even almost the Hungarians. Why do I say that this paradox is instructive to this day? It is because America has not yet abandoned its foolish attempt from time to spread its ideals in places where it instead causes disruption and catastrophe. The Second World War and the subsequent occupation of large part of Central Europe by the Soviet Empire petrified all the old problems and created new ones. They were, of course, put away in the aforementioned freezer. Sooner or later, strategies of national communism were created and functioned in all countries of the Soviet bloc, which did not bring us closer to Europe, although they gradually counterbalanced us from the superpower grip of Moscow. The worst of it was that public reflection of the Central European situation did not continue. Reflection of dissenters and exiles within and even across nations could, in their participants, give the impression that things were changing for the better. Today, I don't think so. That which was changing, that was the growth of distance between involved members of exclusive debates of dissenters and exile, but untouched by the public. For example, the Czech one, even today, is not willing to invalidate a so-called amnesty law in post-war legislation developing those who offer the war carried out, in the words of the law, just retribution, just vengeance. Progress in this direction is for a quarter a century small. I will return to the idea of a political nation. What's their hope? Many of us return to it not only as an ideal, but also as a practical guide. So where, other than in Switzerland, has it been fulfilled? Apparently also in the United States, but then we would have to abstract from the racial issues. A multitude Canada? And what about the mass ethnocide of local Native Americans, Inuits, especially children, which is only in recent years coming to the surface? Recently, my Canadian friend told me about his childhood, showed me a little town on the map near Calgary, and insisted upon the fact that he experienced there firsthand the same circumstances that were present in Alabama. The French political nation? Yes, sure, but what preceded it? Rough, violent assimilation of Bretons, Aquitans, Picards, the people of Gascony and of Provence, creating already a long time ago a political nation in France. Therefore, the happy ones have no idea about difference between the word state and the word nation. They merge them into one. This is not longer quite applies to Corsica, where the local people break this concept of political nation. Similar, the Catalans and Basques who destroy the concept of a Spanish political nation, and maybe even the Scots the concept of a British political nation. Belgium is being held together perhaps only by the glue of Brussels as a headquarters of the institution of the Union. Or is it then the viable way to political nation only separation, secession? Are the Bohemians, Moravians, and Silesians a political nation when we are now alone without the Slovaks, Hungarians, Germans, and the Rusins, and of course even the Jews? Hardly, since we did not get to our current so-called internal ethnic peace by overcoming national conflicts, but rather by mechanical collective detachment. We had a blessing, an unusual advantage. The border with Slovakia was ancient and therefore non-conflicting, and compact minorities did not live on either territory of no independent states. When the nations of former Yugoslavia were seceding, a lot of blood was spilled because the border ran through stripes along the borders and islands of minorities. People were ousted through mass expulsion, and quite a bit of land were destroyed. This is certainly not a viable path. That which was overcome only mechanically, with separation or assimilation, even perhaps without blood, lives on in the minds of the people, merely manifesting itself differently. For some things it is simply just to be late. Hopefully that for which is not too late and is rather instead high time for the creation of bigger units from states, not from nations in the Central Europe sense of the word. Nations are almost always being born maintain and internally reinforce through negative feelings. Identity, the obvious and appreciated identity, always needs the other, but needs it as an enemy, a threat. We cannot do anything about all this. There is therefore only a future in a strong supranational grouping with which its mere existence and its daily functions relativize the importance of borders and thus even the problem of minorities. It is for this reason that I was much a decisive supporter of the Euro region after November, foreshadowing the Schengen area. It would be worth it to take into account at the beginning of early 90s how strong of opponents this pioneering experience had there in this country. Otherwise, of course, these large units, perhaps such as EU, should pose only moderate, gradual goals for themselves. They may have maximum ambitions, but it will be better if they fulfill them very carefully and gradually. I would like to read this context, comparative studies of all possible attempts to create a commonwealth, personal union, federation, or confederation in Central Europe or in Europe. Maybe it exists. Many such attempts have been made. I can simply recall Masaryk and Beneš under different circumstances. Milan Hodža, even under more different ones. Kudenhove, Kalergi, and more. What did they all have in common? Correct instinct commanded to attempt something that isn't a better, more just, or more accurate guidance of borders, because it will never be accomplished. What does this otherwise insoluble problem with borders and naturally also with minorities relativize? It simply gradually reduces its urgency. Why did it all the previous traditional attempts have to fail? It would be useful to know. I would say that Europe, the founding core of its union, was not reasonably prudent nor modest, especially from 1989. It should have opened its gates to us, Central Europeans, only after we were to come together, consolidated, say, like the Benelux countries. Integration was rushed, both deepening and enlargement almost at the same time, maybe even because behind all the haste were economic interests in the new markets. The fundamental meaning of the Union is grounded in the gradual desensitization of old, unhealed wounds, minorities, and uncertain borders was and still is threatened today by this haste. Today, under the impression of an influx of refugees and immigrants, as well as through the consequences of the financial sector of the economy, which has gotten out of hand of states or even hands of union of states, many intend to back out of achieved standards and abolish the gains made toward a Europe without borders. It is a dangerous state of mind, reviving old wounds. So what then? What then when the building political nation, states and citizens, there was initially too little time, and now is instead too late? In many places there is nothing to build from, nothing to build from, when here in Central Europe we are merely the sun of purified islands of homogeneity. Yet surprisingly, the old wounds are once again beginning to vertebrate. In the medical field, this is called phantom pain. We feel pain of part of body which isn't even there anymore. This is due to the fact that we are missing a common European consciousness, and moreover, a central European identity. This consciousness, this identity, cannot be conceived from the green table, nor in the workroom of thinkers. The consciousness of something in common arises only when from a common story. And a common story cannot lack the dramatic decision-making regarding what is more important and what is less important. What will we give preference to and over what? In other words, it cannot be done without sacrifices. Only the victim establishes the order of values. Because some values are exclusive. One is at the expense of other, and it is precisely this common alignment of values that is then his or her story, establishing identity. Europeans are facing far too many problems at the same time, and thus there will be increasingly more opportunities for victims. Yet are we going to be at all willing to undertake any, to give something up that we have already achieved in the name of maintaining the Union, or in the name of upholding the area of free movement, or in the name of achieved an ever-increasing prosperity? I have always been shy to repeat the Patočka-Havel challenge to live in the truth. Live in the truth. Not that I would run in the face of truth, rather the opposite, actually. It's simply I don't know what the truth is. Seeing as I, just like you, am still searching for it. Therefore, I have always felt closest to Solzhenitsyn's more modest idea of not living in a lie, because I sometimes dare to discover the lie. What is what we Central European can do? We cannot and we don't desire to change or fix border any longer. We don't know where the right ones belong, nor if they exist at all. But we can choose not to live a lie, to get rid of all possible illusions and lies, but not to fall victim to cynicism and despair, to return to the past so that we can see more clearly from places upon which we will agree, both the present and hopefully even the future. Yes, we are still conquering former firing sites, old mined fields, and rusted border barricades. But now, not only so we can move on from them fighting, but so that we could use them to understand both the present and hopefully even the future together. Moreover, if we are considering the surprising shortage of common heroes, we should make attempts at their familiarity rather than soldiers or resistance fighters, which we all usually have for oneself. They will rather be thinkers, statesmen, politicians and economists, those who discern a common enemy and those who saw him not only beyond their borders but also within them. They do not have to be renowned heroes. For our Czech team, I nominate our very own philosopher Emanuel Rado, an exile publicist Pavel Tigrid. For the Hungarians, I dare to suggest János Esterházy and István Bíbo. For the Slovakians, Imre Karvaš, and perhaps even Milan Hoxha come to my mind. And for the Poles, Jerzy Giedroyc and Andrzej Wajda. These and similar other lists can surely be created in greater quantity. So my epilogue. We Czechs, Slovaks, Poles and Hungarians did not have a common hero, which was to be expected. But it seemed for a long time that we don't have common enemies. We all had our own national enemies. This was, of course, a symptom of ideological and especially geopolitical blindness. Ethnic interests tend to be blind, selfish, and petty. They are preoccupied with border disputes over a new meters, a percentage over the founding or denying of the rights of minorities. In reality, we have had common enemies from the first years following the First World War. Our enemies were Hitler and Stalin. Maybe many saw it as such, but did not have enough strength to influence the states and nations of Central Europe to act accordingly. Even for this reason, we observed the developing relations with Poles, Hungarians, Slovakians, certain Germans, and last but not least, even our relations with Putin's Russia, the tension and sometimes uneasiness. Peripherally, we register shifts in the political optics of Austrians, understand that Serbs don't have problems with Russia, etc. We keep track of who is clearly committing to the Euro-Atlantic West. A clean table has, therefore, following the year of miracles in the 1989, not arrived. Once again, monologues are being initiated and interested diverging. At least, however, we have stopped chasing such a one decisive table, which I regard as progress. It is nevertheless important to have more of them, but smaller, down to earth, mobile. We don't negotiate new contracts or new borders at these tables, but everyone uses them to tell their story and others try to understand it, even thought they will probably never make of their own. It is impossible. These tables are always needed, even smaller, small ones. They form the now so-called small Visegrad. The governments of the four states may even pass each other, but the small Visegrad in the future, supporting cross-border activities and living mainly of the Visegrad farm, with all connects thousands and thousands of people, especially the youth, not only from our four states. The table will never the table will therefore never be completely clean, but it will have to be larger in a sense so that it can include a larger part of Europe and encompass bigger stretches of time. Our European world will then be able to be more understandable, at least in the sense that we will be able to predict and avoid further unnecessary conflict. I hope that even our presumably unending and wandering conference about our heroes and our enemies and about that of unite us, but also about what separate us, is attempting to achieve something similar, something like a solid table open to the civil society with transparent agenda. The fact that it is already today a war that it will not one day be closed by definitive court or resolution, but rather that it will continue wandering about the entire region, deserves both encouragement and persevere and wishes of good luck in acquiring both good subject and thoughtful participants. Sorry to be so long.